All right, then. So welcome and thanks, everybody, for coming. This is just an opportunity to have the chair and vice chair of the Appropriations Committee here to help give you the big picture view of what's going on in the budget. This obviously was an incredibly difficult year because the governor's budget as presented created some really significant problems that were counter to some of the Vermont values that we were hearing in terms of wanting stability and protection from property taxes. And so the committee had a lot of work to do in moving the budget to balance and sustainability without raising property taxes. And so to sort of hear the thought process behind it and the big picture view of the budget, I'll turn it over to the chair of the committee, Representative Toll.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. The goals of the House Appropriations Committee, obviously, first and foremost, was to pass out a budget that was balanced. That was our first priority. And equally as important was to pass out a budget that aligned our revenues with our spending. We have had our expenditures outpacing our revenues for several years now. And in the past few years, we have made some significant changes in structuring the budget to overturn that path, that course that we were going down. This year, we worked very hard, and with very limited revenue, which included no new taxes and fees, we were able to present a budget, pass it out of committee on a unanimous vote, that the overall unduplicated growth in the budget was 1%. The focus always seems to be on the general fund, and the general fund growth was 1.8%, which we felt was a significant accomplishment of our committee. We had the help of the other committees of jurisdiction within the House that set priorities and assisted with information that we needed to make our critical decisions. We feel that we have made investments for Vermonters in this budget, and we feel that we have carried on investments that have been made in recent years, as well as some new initiatives and some restructuring, using money differently, thinking about how to do things differently. And so we feel we have made some good changes. There's good things, and there's some things in this budget people will not like because there are reductions, and reductions do impact Vermonters. And we have given the administration as much flexibility as possible, so that depending on what happens at the federal level, that the decisions on how to make reductions, especially in the Agency of Human Services, can be done with using RBA methods, outcome measurements in place, and also what the critical need is of grants and programs, so that they're considered very carefully before they are just reduced. So flexibility was key. We're very pleased with the budget. We're excited to bring it to the floor. We're anxious for the debate and for the questions and that we will get, but we really feel we've given every legislator in the House ample opportunity to weigh in. What do you like? What don't you like? How would you do it differently? What proposal would you give us? We have allowed time for testimony. We've met in small groups. We've met offline in coffee shops and area restaurants around the state. We've included many opportunities for Vermonters to weigh in public hearings, for advocates to weigh in. And it has been as open and as transparent as possible. And legislators were told today at a final noon meeting that if you were unable to have your voice heard or unable to come to the committee with ideas and suggestions, that as soon as this budget is out on Friday, we'll return next week and start our work on the FY19 budget. And if you have a good proposal or an idea that you did not get to us in time for this budget, we're all ears next week to start the 19 budget.
All right.
Well, one of the things I'd like to point out here, and Madam Speaker started this as the chair of appropriations over the last 2 years, really a big transparency push in our committee to involve earlier and more completely all the members of the House. And I didn't think it possible to really expand on that, but we have. At our chair's urging, we have gone out and we have briefed committees, talked to committees about what their input might be, made sure that they understood. When I was in government operations, they understood I was their point of contact for the budget. Did they have any questions now or at some point in time? Many of them came to me. We actually had a freshman orientation some 2 weeks ago in the well of the House where we explained to them how you get to the starting line of the budget so they understood what the makeup of the budget was and so that they could better understand the budget and ask good questions when it came time for presentation. This is an extraordinary year that we have had, and the chair is absolutely correct. We have made important either ongoing or new initiatives. One of the pieces that is near and dear to my heart is the drug and alcohol piece. We continue to fully fund all efforts for folks that have stumbled into a problem to try to pull themselves up by their bootstraps and to get clean and sober. And that piece will continue, despite the fact that there's obviously been some closures with the Underhill facility. We have the other two facilities in the state stepping up with additional inpatient beds in Virgins and Rutland. We've got a hub opening very shortly up in St. Albans. We are addressing the issues. And that's about it for now.
So there are a couple of places. I mean, the big story is that... that you were able to balance the budget, balance a $70 million gap. The budget that came to you balanced that with $60 million on property taxes, and you were able to instead balance that with $5 million of increased compliance with existing revenues and tax structures. And I think that's really the biggest shift between the two of them. You also had some very subtle shifts to redirect money from, things like cold weather exemption, rather than paying for motel vouchers to try to invest instead in shelters that could serve more people in a more sustainable way and provide a point of contact for outreach workers, shifting money into community health, into home health agencies and community designated agencies, really trying to bring more people back rather than close the Windsor facility, that it would bring people back from out of state and get more people out of incarceration and out of state facilities that frankly we're having trouble with on occasion. And the choices for care piece
there are three initiatives that we have undertaken to save money. It is a coordination of benefits unit. It is a fraud unit. I'm sorry, I can't remember the exact terminology, but I call it fraud unit.
Medicaid fraud unit.
Yeah, and then the chronic care initiative. So I'll start with the chronic care initiative. All of this will, after we hire some state employees to fill existing vacant positions, so there's no new positions in this bill, we are filling vacant positions, new bodies in vacant positions, we will see savings beyond their payroll and benefits to the tune of more than $1 million, and that money will be reinvested with the home health agencies to increase their pay for folks that have not had an increase in a very long time and do vital work around the state. The Chronic Care Initiative, there's approximately 8,000 individuals in the state of Vermont that have ongoing and serious issues with their health. The current initiative is able to address approximately 2,000 of those folks to try to coordinate their care and ensure that they are receiving care at the time that they need it to hopefully hold costs down, and it's working. With more individuals doing that work, an additional 5 individuals doing that work, we feel that we can harvest even more savings from that and reach more individuals that are on that chronic care list that the agency has. So that's the intent there. coordination of benefits and the fraud. The coordination of benefits is much along the same lines, the fraud unit. We really don't have a fraud unit in the state. I mean, we do with small. It is work that has been done in at the federal government and in other states, and we feel that this is an important aspect to it. So we are applying some resources, some individuals to that effort, and the money that is saved, again, will go towards the home health agency.
Again, that's Medicaid.
Yes.
Medicaid fraud.
So. The speaker also mentioned the cold weather exception. We did make a reduction in the cold weather exception, and we've heard from many, many Vermonters, in which we should, but we simply didn't make a reduction and do nothing else. Our committee had many discussions on the best way to use state money, and we really felt that giving an individual a voucher for a motel room, locking the door behind them that night and leaving in the morning was really not identifying a Vermonter who might be in trouble or who has needs that might need to be addressed. And we thought that the money would be better spent in expanding homeless shelters in Vermont where there are areas of need. If you go to a shelter, you are being identified. And if you are in need of a service, you're much more apt to be identified in a shelter than you are by yourself in a motel with a voucher. And so we added $150,000 to the expansion of homeless shelters, but we also expanded the language for general assistance for flexible funding that now includes emergency housing. And so if there is a need and you do, you know, there you do need a motel voucher, within that flexible funding, it would be available. It is not to have anyone freeze to death on the streets or anywhere in Vermont. So flexible funding will now be available to emergency housing, and there's more money being invested in shelters so we can identify Vermonters who are in need.
Did you increase funding for the flexible?
We, in our bill, we targeted a higher amount. We targeted $200,000 in the bill for flex funding within existing dollars. We are working within existing dollars throughout most of our programs because of the revenue increase rate of growth compared to expenses, and the Ways and Means bill was $5 million for all of state government, which is, you know, billions more than that. And so,
but the flex funding itself got an increase.
Right.
That was increased. Yes.
But that was taken from somewhere else in AHS.
Within existing money, it must be targeted in this area for it.
Basically,
for
motel vouchers. It's trying to shift resources. Right. We've been struggling with increasing costs of the motel vouchers for a number of years. I mean, how many years?
Ever since I've been on the committee.
Yeah. And use of motels in cases of emergency homelessness or emergency housing to address homelessness, use of motels has skyrocketed. And so we have taken a number of steps over the years to invest more in shelters, in emergency housing, in emergency housing with co-located facilities, much like a few initiatives that are in the Burlington area. And every year we've looked and said, okay, geographically, where are the vouchers being used most? And first it was the Burlington area. So some money went in to those facilities, and we saw dramatic decreases in motels. And then, you know, we looked at then Brattleboro and the Northeast Kingdom got some investment. And, you know, Rutland and Barrie, Montpelier area are now the two high users. So we're sort of moving geographically around the state to address regional problems and really work with local communities on regional solutions.
How would this be different in practice for someone who's coming to a community office and it's a cold night? How would their experience be different with flex funding versus a cold weather exception?
A couple of ways. First of all, if you're a family with children, you're not included in, you know, your exemption, that still exists. So women in their third trimester of pregnancy, families coming in with, individuals coming in with children, they are not part of this decision. Those exceptions will still be there. If you're coming in, we will know if there are beds available in shelters, and you will be directed to a bed in a shelter. If there's no capacity elsewhere, then the flexible funding can be used for the motel voucher after other better sources are identified and to see if they're available.
So basically, that's the process that exists now when it's predicted to be, I think, over 20 degrees or over 32 degrees if it's raining. I'm not quite sure if I have those temperatures exactly right. So now this says those rules stay in place even when it gets colder. Because that's what the cold weather exemption is. So we first a few years ago put those rules in place, and that was a long process and a lot of community input. But the cold weather exemption remains, so that the cold weather exemption basically means the rules go out the window when it gets cold in Vermont, and anybody can have access to a motel voucher. So this is saying, you know what, we still need to focus or direct people first towards shelters. It's, frankly, it's less expensive, and people have a chance of being rehoused faster than they do when they have a motel.
Representative Toll, I believe it was you who said, or referenced keeping property taxes essentially flat. Is it your understanding that based on what you've done with the budget, based on the budgets voted by schools, that property taxes that the rates will be flat, or that the bills will be flat for most Vermonters?
Well, that's in a different. Well, it all meets up in the end.
Yeah.
There is an increase in the net education fund. The 1 year growth is 2.7%. In the governor's budget, if it were adjusted with the $10 million, we had to do an adjustment with the governor's budget to compare apples to apples, which is almost impossible with the two.
If we had simply passed the governor's budget, based on all the decisions that Vermonters made in town meeting, the governor's budget would have resulted in a 6.7% increase in the education fund. If with this budget in place and the decisions that Vermonters made on town meeting day, that is 2.7%. So it's the governor's budget would have had almost triple the increase that this budget had.
But Vermonters, not saying that you folks haven't done great work to keep it where it is, but Vermonters mm-hmm. should expect their property tax bills to go up, even if it's a small
amount. And that's based on their local decisions. Based on local decisions. There's nothing that our committee did that would increase property taxes. We did not shift higher education to the property tax. We did not shift child care to the property tax. We did not shift any initiatives to the property tax. And so the increase that you see in our budget documents is solely based on the local decisions when towns pass their school budgets March.
And in fact, your committee increase the amount of general fund money going in to reduce property taxes.
That's correct. So there was a town meeting day. The folks have voted themselves $61 million in increased costs to schools. The budget here will add from $305 million to $314 million general fund transfer to the education fund, so that's an increase of $9 million.
So it's a penny on your property tax
rate. $10 million is a penny on the property tax rates. So this budget, I just want to reiterate, this budget will not cause income taxes to go up, fees to go up, or property taxes to go up. Now, setting the education tax rate, which is supposed to occur sometime today or tomorrow.
Yeah, probably doing it just about now.
Okay. that will impact what the tax rate is, but that is not embedded within our bill.
Speaking of school spending, there's an education spending study in this budget. Why does Vermont need another education spending study?
We're truly trying to find what the cost drivers are for education spending so that we can address it in future years. It's that simple.
But there was just the PECOS report then. How does this differ from that?
How this differs from that. The PICUS report is a more formal report, and the group, it's more of a study group that will meet, and they will use the PICUS report. They will use other reports, any national data. Yeah. They will use resources like the Vermont School Boards Association, the Principals Association. They can reach out, and there have been a few education spending bills before the House, and to look at all the information, and in it really can't be in bill form, but very similar to bill form, a proposal that looks at all of the information on the table to see if there's a direction that Vermont can move in. It's a much smaller group. It's more informal, and it's to bring information back to our committee and to the education committee with real possibilities of how we could either tweak or change education, the funding mechanism.
Looks like you didn't go along with the governor's proposal to get some savings from merging liquor and lottery.
That was never in his budget.
No, but it was a proposal later.
He never told us how all that could happen.
So it's not there. And are you going to go along with his, what do you call it, executive orders?
We're still working with the committees to see where there's some alignment, and I think one of them we can move toward. You know, I think we're still working with the committees on that. In one case, with liquor lottery, the legislature has kind of proposed that before, and so we're trying to think about what that structure would look like and what the implementation would look like and how to not interfere with the really important modernization work that's going on right now. And I think in the area of DII, we're trying to figure out what the problem is that they're trying to solve. Not, you know, DII definitely has some issues, but so far the conversation where we've asked how this structure fixes these problems, it's been a mismatched conversation.
So did you just not know, not understand?
It's not
like
a part
it
of the
saved money.
Well, it's
the
not
locker,
a, it's
literally locker.
Well,
it's just not a part of this budget because we didn't have a specific proposal. The administration still hasn't come forward saying here is exactly how this would work, and so they can't bank on the savings if there's not sort of operational proof that can happen.
We're funding, I'm thinking specifically of the IT projects here, where something was moved out of this budget and into, say, the capital bill. Were corresponding cuts made there to make up for the new costs put in? So, for instance, the IT projects, I believe, was $10 million. Were $10 million in cuts made elsewhere in the capital bill?
They weren't actually $10 million. They showed as $10 million. The governor had them and had those numbers in his original construct. When the institutions committee reviewed the projects, the IT projects, some of them were a 2-year project, and they were looking. We need to look at them 1 year at a time because we appropriate 1 year at a time, and so they were substantially reduced. And the institutions committee had capacity within their bonding ability to take on those projects. I believe they ended up to be about 6.4. They're in the $6+ million range, because they were 2-year, multi-year numbers. But I did want to, can I go back to the 2-year budgeting cycle? It was a priority for the House Appropriations Committee to start 2-year budgeting cycles, and we had 3 tiers. And the most complicated tier was one where there would actually be structural changes. And we've been talking about liquor and lottery. The governor had his executive order. The liquor lottery, or any two groups that would come together for a structural change, would need the work of the policy committee, and we did not have that yet. And the governor had put out at the end of our budget work of the possibility of a savings in liquor and lottery, but we didn't have a firm proposal in hand, and so that's why we couldn't bank on those savings without a firm proposal in hand. But it's in our 2-year construct of the 3 different tiers that we hope to move forward. Whether it's liquor and lottery or another construct, we're still very excited to find a bigger restructuring for savings and efficiencies that would help going forward with the state budget.
Did you agree with any of the governor's requests for increased spending, specifically in education, but I guess any area, the new grants that you proposed or things like that?
Well, I think that we agreed with the increased spending, but finding the money proved to be more difficult.
Did anything make it into the budget?
We were able to... No, we didn't have millions of dollars to give $4 million to the state colleges or $9 million to childcare, which are all deserving programs that need the money. What we did do, we were able to find within the $4 million he identified for the state colleges, between the capital bill, they found $600 in an R bill. $600,000. And we found the other $280,000 so we could continue with our agreement, our commitment for the unification of Linden State College and Johnson. Additionally, we did a different construct than the governor. We looked at the higher ed trust fund, and we trifurcated it between if it goes to UVM, the state colleges, and VSAC, and not to have VSAC or UVM feel any of the pressure. We trifurcated the fund, and we assigned $2 million to the state colleges to be used for operating money to help shore them up.
Is that an increase over what they had this current year?
Yes, absolutely.
$2 million
One time.
Are you not sort of taking from the students to give to the college?
That is why we trifurcated the fund, because we felt that the need at the state colleges is critical at this time, and unless they are shored up and remain solvent, students attending those colleges could be in jeopardy. And they're very important for educational opportunities. And if you think of the Northeast Kingdom, this is an institution that is desperately needed for kids to access college. And without it, it would be obviously would have an economic impact for the Northeast Kingdom. But more importantly, it would have an educational impact on many high school students that need to commute and go to school part-time and work, or adults that are going back to finishing degrees. It's critical. The colleges are critical for the areas in Vermont where they're situated.
How much of this no new taxes and fees do you feel like is something you wanted to do, or is a flavor that the governor put out there that you had to follow?
I think a bunch of that conversation... a bunch of that conversation was really, I think, shaded with the federal government. You know, when we think about what could be facing us on the federal level, this was a chance to not do a whole lot of expansion, because in 6 months we could get information that completely upends our priorities and what we consider the most important resources. So I think feeling like not significantly expanding programs was important, so that we could really be prepared for what could come at us federally. I mean, we're talking hundreds of millions of dollars, and some of that is money that comes directly to or through the state government, but some of that is also money that is critical to the fabric of Vermont that state government never sees, because it goes, you know, directly to an individual for for a health care benefit or something. You know, the Affordable Care Act got a stay of execution a week ago, but we're not, you know, that's not a promise for the future. There are nonprofits that receive direct federal grants that could disappear, and so we could be facing some pretty serious issues in the fall that we need to be prepared for and need to have some capacity for.
But how much is that it would be tough to override a veto also?
I mean, I think that's a piece where we were trying to come in and say, hey, let's all work together. Obviously, this budget is significantly different than what we got in some key ways that we outlined earlier. But But it's been important to this committee for a long time to put us on a more sustainable path, to really get our fiscal house in order, to work to make state government more efficient and provide more direct service. I think the steps that we've taken in the last few years are all a big piece of that.
With this, go ahead.
I can't think of a day that the House Appropriations Committee was under a shadow making decisions, being worried about a veto. I don't think we even had the conversation around the table. Our focus was on restructuring the budget so that the infamous alligator mouth, that we could make bend the curve and bring spending into alignment with revenues. That was our major focus. And the only way to do that was really finding reductions. And that is why we allowed so much flexibility in this budget, because those reductions are going to be painful and difficult. And not knowing what's coming down from the federal level, we don't want to make reductions in this area where reductions are made here on the federal level. So it allows the secretary and the administration to align anything that happens in Washington with what we can do here to adjust the budget. So I don't think that we were ever under the cloud of a veto. We were doing our job to to make structural changes in the budget, to make it sustainable, and also to set ourselves up so when there are federal reductions, we're in the best place possible. And I do want to say that our reserves are in pretty good shape. They're above the statutory levels, and we have done a construct looking at special funds to bring our rainy day reserve up from 6.8% up to $10 million. And that's one of the projects that we're going to start looking into for 19 are our special funds, what their balances are, those that are in a negative balance to start addressing that, those that should be closed. And so we're trying to tee up a lot of things for 19 with the work we've done in the 18 budget.
Part of that answer anticipated my question, which is you referenced the alligator's mouth. Will it reemerge in 19 if this budget goes the way it's anticipated? So barring some big economic shift, is the alligator's mouth finally closed?
It should be.
We're getting... It is closing. It took us a long time to get into that problem, and it's taking some... it's multiple steps to get out of it. It's the other half of the alligator's mouth, the bottom jaw, is the revenues. So depending on what revenues do, and frankly, that's going to a big part of that revenue is the federal government. So that's why this is really focusing on bringing down those growth rates and creating a lot of structural stability and a little more long-term vision for that strong, healthy future. And we don't have a whole lot of control over the biggest piece, the biggest single source of those revenues, which is the bottom half of that alligator mouth, which is the federal government.
But as this stands, would this leave a projected budget gap for 19 before you start work on that in a week?
I'm not sure.
I don't know.
Well,
yeah.
The part of the problem with that question is that revenues aren't necessarily forecast out.
Sure, yeah.
We aren't right now working with a solid number on next year's revenue forecast. But as we bring down that growth rate, the growth rate of 1% for the overall budget and 0.8% for all state funds is tremendous work to help bring that in line and create that sustainability.
Yeah, the economy, let's say the economy is growing at 2%, even be conservative there, that puts you in good shape without federal changes, right?
Yes. It's the federal pieces that are good. We have time for a couple more, and I know...
But there's so many variables. That's why to give an answer of yes or no, can we count on it being, equal going into 19? There's too many variables on match rates in Medicaid, on the health of Vermonters, federal decisions.
Next year, snow season, ski season. this does put us in an incredibly strong, stable place moving forward.
So ahead of the debate tomorrow, what areas of the budget are you expecting pushback on? Or do you have any amendments?
Well,
to?
You know,
boy, if we give you ideas and people read them, I don't know if we want to do that.
I'm really curious about the debate tomorrow. I'm really quite interested because I don't remember a time when legislative members have had so much opportunity for input and questions and bring us your concerns. And it's fine. We want to hear the debate on the House floor. You know, people need to know the restructuring we've done with corrections, and they need to know the change in policy with the cold weather exception. But, you know, if somebody comes to the table and says, why isn't there more economic development in your bill? Well, where have you been for the last 6 weeks when I've asked you to come to my committee? What do you want to see? How would you find the money to fund it? What are the problems you have with the budget? Where are your concerns? Where would you like to see restructuring? We have opened our committee doors for formal testimony, informal conversations, small groups, large groups, community groups. And so if a legislator has a major concern with something that is missing in this budget or spending that we have had, I'm just really confused. Why haven't I heard it yet? So I'm hoping it's informational
tomorrow.
And I tomorrow.
Think, you know, I mean, you haven't had the pushback from your caucus that you've
had
in years past.
And we've had incredible input from all three sides of the aisle. All three political parties here have input to us. So,
Representative Fagan. Go ahead, Terry.
How does it compare to other years for Republicans, do you think?
I had somebody say that they never thought they would see a growth rate in the general fund below 2% to me, and this is 1.8%. The overall growth rate of 1% in grand total, if you back out the education piece of $61 million, that's actually just below 0.9%. So this is an extraordinary piece of work that we've come together and worked as and produced as a committee. Really proud of all of us upstairs. This has been an extraordinary, difficult piece of work to get to, but budget should be. So.
The Senate has been looking at increasing pay for workers at designated agencies to $15 an hour or some comparable to other sectors, and there's a part in this budget that asks the Secretary of Human Services to come with a plan for employee wages at designated agencies. Is that a sign that the House does not agree with the Senate's approach right now to increase that for this coming year?
So the Senate still needs to put together a budget that accommodates that. Mm-hmm. I think we just need to, you know, wait and see what the Senate's full proposal is.
Okay.
I do want to say, to build upon Peter's comments, that the work of the Appropriations Committee has not been political at all. It's been the work of a committee. And we haven't, you know, had the chomping at the neck of either of our caucuses. We've had the input from people who want to get a great state budget out or the best budget that we can get out possible. And there has not been any political tug of wars within our committee. It's a document from 11 individuals sitting around the table, getting the information they need, and getting something out that works the best that it can for Vermonters.
That's great.
Yep.
So you all believe that the votes are there to pass the budget?
Yes.
Well, I hope so.
Is it going to be unanimous?
I hope so.
Boy, wouldn't that be something? I'm not willing to bet on that, but I think...
Not me either.
You know, the indications that we're getting right now are that it will be a strong vote,
which is I'll let you. What do you recall from your chair days?
So, we got in past budgets that the three of us worked on together. We did have tripartisan support on things, but I'll be watching to see if we break the 100 number. Thanks, everybody.
I won't be watching at all.